We don't have any misgivings about his eating and drinking. We are not joining that crowd that called Jesus a glutton and a wine bibber. No, I understand eating and drinking. Eating and drinking means to me the promised land flowing with milk and honey and enjoyment of all the blessings of God, the blessing of God coming to reality, the blessing of Abraham becoming mine. Me enjoying into, me entering into the real enjoyment of good things, right?
We stand and lift up our hands for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He. Together we sing.
My products show what kind of a person I am. What comes out of my ministry, my life, will show who I am. Ultimately, that's the proof. You shall know them by their fruit, right? They could not comprehend Jesus. They said, how can this man? He must not be a spiritual man. If he's a spiritual man, see, their thing is, in our town, if you're spiritual, you fast. You're always fasting. How come this guy, where did he come from? He's not fasting. He's not fasting enough, at least. Why is he not fasting? He's always eating and drinking. They could not understand. Well, if they understood that this is Moses, and Moses is not about fasting. Moses is about promised land. Moses is a prophet that has come to speak about the promised land and the blessing of the promised land of milk and honey, right? And he has come to take people there. His message is not leading into poverty. His message is leading into the blessings of God, into the fullness of life. So, as soon as you understand that, you will understand why Jesus' activity was more celebrative with festive meals. Celebrating what? Celebrating the presence of the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God has come. You know. So he celebrates every meal, every fellowship. Every time they sat around the table, they fellowshiped eating and eating and drinking and celebrating the presence of the kingdom. So immediately, once you understand that Jesus has come, he represents a totally different ideology. He's taking the people into the promised land. He's another Moses. You know, he's not here to talk about poverty. How can Moses talk about poverty? He came to deliver people from poverty. They were in poverty. They were in Egypt in poverty. He came to deliver them from the chains of poverty and nothingness and brought them into the promised land. How can our new Moses, Jesus, who is Moses, talk about poverty? If he is Moses, then he will not be talking about poverty. He'll be talking about the good and vast land, land flowing with milk and honey. See, immediately, you know, you begin to understand what this is all about. The second passage is Luke chapter 5, verse 33. Then they said to him, why do the disciples of John fast often and make prayers? And likewise, those of the Pharisees, but yours eat and drink. John the Baptist's disciples fast and pray. Pharisees' disciples also do the same. They are very prayer champions, they are. They made a religion out of prayer, you know. You know, in so many religious circles, they've made a religion out of how many hours did you pray? How many days do you fast? They have made a total religion out of prayer and fasting. You know, they've got a whole set of rules about fasting, prayer, and all that business, you know. And the Pharisees were about that. I think they, as soon as you meet them, they'll say, on what days do you fast? How many days did you fast this week? How many hours do you pray today? You know, prayer is a religious activity for them. You know, that's why they're counting the time and say, oh, it's 1 hour. I prayed 1 hour today. Tonight I'll pray 1 hour. You know, that's the way they took it, you know. And it's never like that. Prayer is talking to God, my friend. And you want to talk to God as much as possible, you know. You know, you're not looking at your watch, you know. Well, God, I got to go, you know. It's not like that. You are talking to God. It's the most precious time of the day, you see. You're not counting the minutes and time, you see. One fellow came to me and said, pray that I will pray 1 hour. I said, why? What's the problem? He said, I must pray 1 hour, brother. I told my church I'll pray 1 hour every day, but I'm able to pray not more than 10 minutes. So you pray for me. Prayer is a religious activity to these people. Religious people carrying out a religious activity. You know, it should never be preached like this. Prayer is a wonderful activity of our fellowship with God, talking to our Heavenly Father. See, it must not be brought down to simple rules, you know, of this and that, you know. Similarly, fasting, you know. Fasting must not be brought down, you know, how many days do you fast? This is Tuesday, so you must fast. They're bringing all these kinds of things, you know. You know how you fast? You know, as a Christian, as a true believer, as a one who loves the Lord, you know, have you ever felt there are times when you have not been fellowshipping with the Lord as much as you ought to, and that you need to do more and you want to do more? There is hunger. There is a spiritual hunger. Therefore, you set aside one day or one meal or something, and you sit with your Bible and you read and you pray and you meditate. And not even eat your midday meal or evening meal or something. Because you are hungry. You want that. Because it's like water. You know, you need water, so you drink it. You know. It's not like you drink 2 glasses in the morning, 3 glasses in the afternoon, 3 glasses. You know, you gotta drink whenever you feel thirsty. That's a good time to drink. Whenever you feel hungry, that's a good time to eat. But people make it into religion, you know. So these fellows are into their religion, and they're trying to impose their religion on Jesus. They say, we all fast, but yours, eat and drink. They say that, yours, eat and drink. And he said to them, listen to the answer. Can you make the friends of the bridegroom fast while the bridegroom is with them. You know what he's saying? He's saying, can you make the wedding guests fast while the bridegroom is with them? This is bridegroom's house, man. Bridegroom is here. We're having a party. We are enjoying. We are rejoicing. The wedding is going to take place. A great event is going to happen. We are in a celebrative mood. Now, don't come and bring your fasting today. Let's keep it some other time. That's exactly what he's saying. The bridegroom is with them. How can you expect them to fast? But the days will come when the bridegroom will be taken away from them. Then they will fast in those days. Then he spoke a parable to them. Now, whenever he speaks a parable, then they better be ready because bullets are coming now. Parable, as far as I can understand, parables are like this with Jesus. He wants to really hit them hard, and he wants to spare them. Like he doesn't want to be, you know, very hurtful. He doesn't want to say, you fool, or something like that, you know. So he wants to be kinder. So he says, let me tell you a story. That's another way of calling the guy a fool anyway, you know. But telling a story to prove that. So whenever he tells us, he's very, you know, I learned a lot of things from Jesus. And you need to learn a lot of things from Jesus too. Look, listen to this. He says, spoke a parable to them. No one puts a piece from a new garment on an old one. Otherwise, the new makes a tear, and also that piece that was taken out of the new does not match the old. When you join the new and the old, it doesn't match for one thing. The colors are different. One is nice and new, and the other is dull. And the new makes a tear, right? Because in strength, they are different. And no one puts new wine into the old wineskins. In other words, he's calling them old wineskins. Now, wineskins are some kind of a leather containers into which they put wine. And when it ferments, it expands. And so the leather already expanded much because already wine has been put in it. But if you bring and put new wine in there, it has no more place to expand. It has expanded as much as it can. Now, if you put new wine in it, you better be careful because it's going to tear up the wineskin because the wine is going to ferment in it and it's going to cause expansion and the skin container is going to tear up. He says, no one puts new wine into the old wineskin, else the new wine will burst the wineskins and be spilled and the wineskins will be ruined. In other words, he's saying, I'm the new wine. You can't even understand my joy and my rejoicing. My eating and drinking, you can't understand. You can never digest. Hello? Why? Because you're old wineskin. If I even start to explain this to you, you're going to go crazy. You won't even comprehend what I'm all about. You are not even able to understand what I'm all about. So, you know, that's why I don't try to explain everything to you. That's exactly what he's saying. Because you're old wineskin. You put the new wine in the new wineskin, he says. Now, but we are new wineskin. Hello? You and I are new wineskin. Born again, regenerated, we have the Holy Spirit. Now you can put the new wine. We can sit here and we can see exactly the point. We can understand exactly what Jesus meant. We don't have any misgivings about his eating and drinking. We are not joining that crowd that called Jesus a glutton and a wine bibber. No, I understand eating and drinking. Eating and drinking means to me the promised land flowing with milk and honey and enjoyment of all the blessings of God, the blessing of God coming to reality, the blessing of Abraham becoming mine. Me entering into the real enjoyment of good things, right? That is exactly what Jesus was doing. The kind of enjoyment that Jesus was having was a legitimate enjoyment. It is something that God can look and say, it's good, very good, very good, right? Do you know that there are things in our life that God can look at it and say, it's very good? And if you are in that position, if you're doing things in that way and enjoying life where God can see and say, that's very good, then that's good, my friend. Enjoy it. You have every right to enjoy it because it's God-given enjoyment. If God can truly look at your enjoyment and say, I like it, it's very good. He's eaten some good food, very good. He's got some nice clothes, very good. He's got a nice house, very good. He's got nice, comfortable cot to sleep in, very good. Why? Because he's not sleeping there, forgetting God and God's laws and, you know, has no relationship with God and sinning left and right. No, no, no. He's a man who's devoted to God, loving God, serving God. It's his meat to do the will of God. Therefore, everything is good. His enjoyment is good. These people are seeing something evil in it, but there is no evil in it. There's nothing wrong with this kind of eating and drinking because he is going around doing the will of the Father. He's about his Father's business. He's traveling everywhere, going and preaching and doing things, healing people, preaching the gospel, the kingdom of God. And sure, he's eating, sitting in the table. There is celebration, rejoicing. God says, that's very good. Nothing wrong. Don't let anybody condemn you. You know, there's a lot of people that will come around and call you all kinds of things, you know, because you enjoy something good. Yeah? You go on enjoying. Just make sure that God looks at it and says it's very good. That's all. Don't bother about what people say. Just make sure that God can truly look at it and say, that is very good, I like it. That's what it's all about, all right? And then the wedding of Cana of Galilee. Now, the story is in John's Gospel, chapter 2. I want to read just the last verse, verse 11, the story ends. This beginning of signs Jesus did in Cana of Galilee, John says, commenting on the miracle, he says, this beginning of signs Jesus did in Cana of Galilee and manifested his glory. Beginning of signs means first miracle. And manifested his glory, and his disciples believed in him. It's the first miracle, so he wants to make a statement. It's a very important miracle because he wants to make a statement about who he is, what he's come to do. What has he come to do? You know, in every wedding almost, you hear somebody preaching on John chapter 2. You know, most weddings, you can tell exactly what the preacher is going to preach. That's why I never go there in weddings, you know, because already so many people are preaching about it. So I'll just preach on something else. One day I went to a very traditional place, and a lot of traditional pastors were there. So I thought, let's not get into any trouble, just preach from John chapter 2. So I opened John chapter 2, and lo and behold, only prosperity is coming out. So I talked about the 6 jars and 180 gallons of wine, and how Jesus, by this first miracle, manifested forth his glory. And I was telling those people how God will meet their needs and he'll be the Lord of their lives and there will not be anything lacking. I mean, it's just coming out, you know. What can I do? And one preacher, at the end of the thing, he says, even in wedding, you are preaching prosperity. I said, I didn't preach it for you, man. I preached it for that guy, poor guy, the guy getting married. He looked like he was scared, you know. That girl looks nice, and he probably took one good look at her and said, I don't know what she'll be demanding me. What all she wants, can I provide? I've got a small salary. I just got into a job. I'm just starting. How can I meet all her needs? How am I going to make it? How's the future going to be? Am I going to get along with her? Is things going to be fine? He's thinking about all that, and he's getting really scared. And me as a preacher, it's my job to put him at rest, you know. So I told him, don't worry, everything will be all right. The Jesus who was there in Cana of Galilee will be with you always. Make your marriage and your life wonderful and beautiful because he's a Lord that fills you with every good thing. What is wrong with that? You know, they will preach the Cana of Galilee, but never preach that, you know. They will never preach that. They will never say that this is what he will do, you know. Because they don't see that at all. They cannot see that. But Jesus, remember, he's Moses. He's taking them to the promised land. Remember what Moses said when he came to the people of Israel as a deliverer when God sent them? He said, come, let's go. I'm going to take you to the land flowing with milk and honey, a large and a vast land. He was not preaching poverty. He was telling them about a good land, a vast land, promised land that they were going to go into, and that God is going to bless them and so on. So this is a new Moses. No wonder, as he does the first miracle, he wants to make that statement. He says, come on, I have come to fill your life with joy and peace and every good thing, you know, in abundance. And so we have no problem in understanding that, because we understand that Jesus comes as another Moses, and he is here to take us into the promised land. And that is why he was speaking the way he was speaking and behaving the way that he was behaving. The eating and drinking is all about that. The reason why his disciples were not fasting but eating and drinking is also because of that. Because they were representing this whole idea of going into the promised land. Fourthly, that other passage, Mark chapter 14 and verse 3. And being in Bethany at the house of Simon the leper, as he sat at the table, a woman came having an alabaster flask of very costly oil of spikenard. Then she broke the flask and poured it on his head. But there were some who were indignant among themselves and said, why was this fragrant oil wasted? For it might have been sold for more than 300 denarii and given to the poor. And they criticized her sharply. 300 denarii means, in that day, 1 denarii is 1 day's wage. So 300 is almost a 1 year's wage. So no wonder they were so upset, because she broke it and poured it on Jesus' head. Jesus said, let her alone. Now look at Jesus' response. Let her alone. Why do you trouble her? She has a good work for me. She has done a good work for me. He's actually saying he's done a good work. She's done a good work. He didn't say, it's all right, she's broken it, what to do, leave her. No, he said, she has done a good work. Don't trouble her. Don't stop her. And then he makes a second statement, for you have the poor with you always. This is even worse. And whenever you wish, you may do them good. But me, you do not have always. She has done what she could. She has come beforehand to anoint my body for burial. Assuredly, I say to you, wherever this gospel is preached in the whole world, what this woman has done will also be told as a memorial to her. Now, what is in this story to tell wherever the gospel is preached? This woman comes and pours the oil on his head, the expensive oil. Everybody objects, but she pours, and Jesus says, it's all right, she's done a good thing. And Jesus says, whatever she has done will be told everywhere where the gospel is preached. Let me ask you, what is in this story to be told everywhere the gospel is preached? Just think about that. What is in this story? See, they could not understand what that girl understood, the woman that broke the oil understood. They thought, with this we can feed so many people. With this we can provide clothes for so many people. With this we can sell and give to the poor and serve some good purpose. That's the way people think normally. And they were thinking along the same lines. But she saw him, and she poured the oil, that expensive bottle, didn't mind it at all. You know why? Because she saw him, she understood that he's the Savior.
Let's clap our hands. When you sing this, sing it like a prayer, right? Really meaning it.
As I wake, you make me strong.
You make me everybody strong,
as I long,
draw me to your arms,
as I stand and sing your praise. You come and fill this place. Won't you come and fill this place?
And fill this place and to make your presence known in our midst.